Good morning, Hope Center.
Good morning.
It's so good to have you with us today. What a beautiful, wonderful day to worship our God. And are we not grateful to Him today? I don't know about you, but on my way to church, I find myself praising Him and thanking Him. And I start going through my list of thanks. Thank you, Lord, for this. Thank you, Lord, for that. Thank you, Lord, for my children. Thank you, Lord, for my grandchildren. Thank you, Lord, for my beautiful daughters-in-law. And the list just keeps going on and on and on. I'm just so very, very grateful to the Lord, and I know you are too. Amen. And that's why we're here today. We come to worship our God, to say thank you to Him, to say praise to Him, to worship and lift His name on high. Amen. To lift His name on high. So, Lord, we are here today. We want to feel Your presence, but most of all, we want to thank You. So, Lord, thank You. We have so many blessings. Sometimes it's hard to see the blessings because we see fear, we see lack, we see discouragement. But, oh Lord, today open our eyes. Help us to see all that we have, all that You've given, all that You are.
Amen.
And You are a God who provides. You are a God who takes care of. You are our good shepherd. And You not only give us just enough, but our cup overflows. Our cup overflows. So thank You, Lord, and we lift Your name on high.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, we're excited to see the Canadians back. Come on, give them a hand back there. Psalms 34:8 says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who puts his trust in the Lord."
Yes,
God is good, Hope Center.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
I saw the Lord and He answered me.
Hope Center. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Praise the Lord. Psalms 1 said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of the sinner, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in that law he meditates day and night. He will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season. Let me be like a tree.
Let me be like a tree.
Team, are they not the best? Yes, yes. Come on, let's hear it. Are they not the best? Yes, yes. You bet. Thank you, Lord, for our worship team. Well, I want to welcome you again to Hope Center Christ. My name is Sheila Coleman. Some people call me Pastor Sheila. Call me Sheila, please, okay? Whatever you do, I don't care what you call me. You can even call me Hey. You know, it doesn't matter. I'm here to be your friend and to walk with you and to love you, all of us, the pastors, and all of us here at Hope Center of Christ. Our goal is to walk with you as Christians and to love you with God's love, with the love of Jesus Christ, to the best of our human ability. So I want to welcome you, all of you who are here today, those of you who are visiting, and whether you've come for 100th time or 400th time or 1,000th time or brand new, please fill out one of these connection cards. They should be in the right in front of you in your pew. And what we need to know is we'd like to know contact information so we can send you emails, and we also would like to be able to pray for you. So if you have a prayer request, no matter what it is, please feel free to write it on there. If you feel like it needs to be an anonymous prayer request, that's fine too. God knows who wrote the prayer. We will pray for you, and I will tell you that this church, this humble church, Hope Center of Christ, I would call us humble, we see answers to our prayers, and we're just really grateful to that. We're grateful to the Lord for that. So please feel free to put them on there. And also, if you have a praise, put that on there as well, because we love to hear how God has answered prayers. Also, in a few minutes, we'll be receiving our tithes and morning offerings. And we ask that you continue to support us. We want to thank you for those of you who support, who watch us on the internet. Your tithes and your gifts are essential to keeping us, you know, afloat. And we are pretty much a volunteer ministry. All of the pastors are 100% volunteer. And we donate our time because we love the Lord. And so the money that we receive pretty much goes to paying for our chapel and for overhead expenses primarily. And we do give some help to our musicians as well, because they travel a ways to get here. So we're so grateful. We want them to know how much we appreciate them. But that's where it goes. But we believe in tithing, giving 10%. The Bible tells you to do that. My husband and I have practiced that our entire life. Even when we could not afford it, we've always done it. And we have a testimony to tell you that God has always provided. It wasn't always easy, but he always provided. Our cup truly has always overflowed, always. And so we encourage you to follow that example, because God says, test me, try me and see. So we ask for that. We also challenge you every summer. Give a little bit more than your average, because it's summer. People go on vacation, our attendance, churches everywhere, their donations go down. Typically, churches operate in the red, meaning their expenses exceed their income for that reason, that their attendance is down with travel. So we've always challenged, and God has always given us what we've needed for the summer. So we're going to be asking you to do that as well, because God says, ask and you shall receive, and it goes to a good cause. Now, part of us, our church, is missions. We're very, very concerned about helping people who are in need. And we have a mission book drive, and there's still time to bring a book. And it can even be a Christian book, and it's for a public school teacher, and we're bringing books for her, and I haven't brought mine yet, but I have till next week. So those of you who haven't brought one yet, I'm not going to make you raise your hand, even though I'm raising mine. I'll embarrass myself, but I don't believe embarrassing others. So if you haven't brought your book yet, there's still next week, okay? So bring your book. Bring more than one book if you want to. This is our little mission for a school that's impoverished, and the teacher, you know, I was a public school teacher. We pay a lot of our supplies right out of our pocket. So we want to help, and we can actually give Christian books for this classroom too. So that's a cool thing. All right. And in 2 weeks, my last announcement, 2 weeks, not next Sunday, but the following Sunday, that's September 4th, I believe. That first Sunday in September is Labor Day weekend. Everybody knows Labor Day weekend. Now, let me tell you about Labor Day weekend. It's the one Sunday of the year that we here at Hope Center Christ get free parking. Unless you park in the library, where we normally get free parking. They might charge you $10 for parking there on Labor Day weekend. Everybody's trying to make a buck off of Labor Day weekend because that's a great big street fair. You might run into some streets that are blocked off that you're used to coming down. Just keep going down to the next block. You'll eventually get here. I worried about it, but because last year was our first year here, I believe, for Labor Day, or second year. And I found a parking place about one block away on the street. So any rate, that's in 2 weeks. That's also communion and our potluck Sunday. Okay? A wonderful Sunday. I can't wait to celebrate it with you. We love the communion of our Lord's partaking of our Lord's Supper and remembering the price that he paid for us on the cross and communing with him and then staying and fellowshipping with each other as we break bread together in more ways than one. That's in 2 weeks from now. So today, for a scripture, I would like to introduce to you and call up a dear, dear, dear friend of mine. Her name is Liz Andrade. Here it comes, Liz. Liz was my administrative assistant back at the Hour of Power, and she's the most impressive young woman that I've ever had the privilege of being able to spend time with, and I'm embarrassing her now. Sorry. Stop it some more, she said. I just want you to know a little bit about her. She's a young mom, and she's a beautiful wife, and a strong career woman. She's just very, very accomplished at a young age. I was shocked at how young she was when she came to work for me, and she already had her bachelor's from Cal State Fullerton, and now she's working. Are you working on your master's? Of course, yeah. See, that's ambitious. Impressive, Liz, but she has a heart for the Lord, and she's going to read our scripture for us this morning. Thank you, Liz.
Thank you. And I'm here because Beth has asked me to read scripture. This is not something that I would normally volunteer to do, to speak in front of a crowd, but when I am called to, I will respond. And so I have been blessed by this scripture already. As soon as I received the call to what scripture we would have for this week, I was extremely blessed. And so my hope is that you are also blessed by it. And so the reading for this morning is from Isaiah 43, 1, 2, 3. And it reads, "But now this is what the Lord says, he who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." Amen.
Thank you, Liz. Thank you. And I will tell you that was my father's mother, my grandmother, Schuler. That was her favorite verse. Those are her favorite verses. And as she was dying, my aunt read them to her on her last breath. So that's a very special verse for me. Thank you, Liz. Beautiful. All right. In a moment, we will be accepting and taking the tithes and offerings that you have to give to our church and to our Lord, especially these are gifts to our Lord. Let us pray over them now. Lord God Almighty, we just thank you, thank you, thank you for all that you have given. Oh, God, so much. We are so grateful. Our hearts overflow with gratitude. Lord, you do provide. You save us from the rivers. You save us from the fire. You are our Savior, and you call us by name. We've seen you do that in our life, and so we thank you for what you've done in the past. You are here with us today. We praise you for that, your presence here today in the present. And Lord, we trust you with tomorrow. We need not fear, for you pave the way. You hold us by our hand, and you never, ever, ever let us go. So thank you, Lord. Accept these tithes and offerings as gifts of love to you, our Abba. Amen.
To proclaim your mind. Good morning. Good morning. How is everybody? Good. Good to see you. Thank you, Sheila, Pastor Sheila, Sheila, whatever we want to call you. friend. Thank you, Liz, for that scripture reading. That was beautiful. And praise team, thank you for always, always providing the most beautiful praise music. We so appreciate you. Thank you so much. So, if you noticed, I have a little hitch in my get along this morning. I just have to tell you guys what happened last night real quick. So I was getting ready to go to bed, remembered one more thing I had to do, right? So I jumped up and ran in the kitchen to do this last thing, and something was on the floor, and I hit it, and I leg flew out from under me. I went down on my knee. My ankle twisted this way. My hip went that way. Yeah, it was kind of comical. I hit the trash can. The lid flew off the trash can, boinked me in the head. So there I sat screaming, come get me up. So Brian came, got me up, and by God's grace, I'm going to be fine. It's going to be good. I just thought if you saw me limping around a little bit, you know what the deal is. I got a little hitch in my get along. But it is just such a great honor to be here in the house of the Lord every Sunday, every single Sunday when I get up and get ready to come to the house of the Lord, I get excited. And I think about how we get excited when we go to ball games or we go to concerts and we see different people. And that's how you should feel about getting up and getting ready for church. You ought to feel like a teenager getting ready for prom when you're coming to church, full of anticipation, ready to hear from God, just wondering and waiting for what God has to say to you. So I know that God has got something to say to us today, and I know that he's going to speak to you. I know that there are people in here who are probably facing fears, who've gone through some things, and so we just give this time to God, and let's just have a quick prayer. Father God, we just praise you this morning. Lord, we lift our praises to you. Lord, we want you to have your way today, Father. Holy Spirit, enter into this place and speak to your people, Father. For anyone who's facing some kind of fear today, Father, I pray that your word will minister to them, will encourage them, and will strengthen them when they leave this place today. Father, I love you. We all love you. We adore you. And we just want to bring honor and glory to you. In Jesus' holy name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen, amen. Okay, so yes, we're on holy ground today in the presence of God Almighty. So I want to speak to you about facing your fears with confidence. I've been hearing the word fear a lot lately, and that's why I chose the topic, because I've heard that word so much. And I did a little research to see just what kind of fears are common to man and what's going on in the world. So I want to try something today just to show you briefly, real quick, right out the gate, how we can conquer a fear. You know what one of the greatest fears is for people? Change. People do not like change. And church, I have to tell you, I've noticed, and not the visitors, and thank you, all you visitors. I meant to tell you guys thank you. I have a loyal bunch of friends that come out when I speak, and God bless you all. I love you. You make me feel so good when you're here. But I've noticed something, church. A lot of you sit in the same seat, the same pew, every single solitary Sunday. It's time for some change. Everybody on your feet. Everybody get on your feet today. Come on, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, do not be afraid. God is with you. Okay, now I want everybody to move. I want you to sit somewhere you've never sat before. And if you are feeling especially courageous, sit with somebody you never sat with before. And this goes for the praise team, too. I'm going to shake y'all up today. You guys are always together. Go scatter. Scatter abroad. Go a different place. Visitors, you guys are probably okay, but, you know. So everybody get a different point of view. Wow, you're a noisy bunch when you move. Hey, you might see something you've never seen before. Oh, this is good. I'm loving this. This is good. Conquering the fear of change. Look at my church. Wow. All right. Looking good, church. Looking good. I love it. Oh my gosh, I so love it. Look at the Balikos are all excited. They get to sit up front. Woo woo. See? Look at there. Okay, settle down, folks. Okay, look at you guys all courageous and everything, facing that fear of change. I'm so proud of you, so proud of you. All right, okay. So we don't ever, and the point in doing this too, is we don't ever want to become complacent. We don't want to ever become so settled into a routine that we miss a new thing that God might have for us. And I want you to always remember Deuteronomy 31:8 says, the Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. So the next time you're facing a fear, think about what you did here today in church. I faced the fear of change, and I did it. Everybody did it. Everybody still looks upright and in a good position. So we're all right. So now we're going to talk about these other fears. I did a little research online, and I found some fears. What I found was all different kinds of lists. Fear is a huge topic. But one of the things I found a list that talked about the most researched fears. So I kind of like that list. I decided to go with that. Sarah's going to put that up now for you. And we're going to go over that real quick. Here are the fears that most people are looking for information on. Number one, fear of flying. Fear of flying. I'm not crazy about it myself. We all do it, and sometimes afraid. Number two, I found to be really interesting, fear of public speaking. Most people always tell me, I don't know how you do that. Oh, I couldn't do that. I'd be so afraid. Well, you know, I'm a little afraid, but not too bad. But fear of public speaking. Fear of heights. There's this one made me think about, there's a Ferris wheel at California Adventure that goes way up high. And Sarah used to make me ride that thing all the time. And they had this one carriage that Raul knows what I'm talking about. This carriage that rocks back and forth. And I mean, I white knuckled that thing every inch of the way. I hated it. But I would do it in trade to ride Tower of Terror. So she would ride Tower of Terror with me. But yeah, fear of heights. Fear of the dark. Fear of the dark. Why is it every time if my husband is gone at night, as soon as the lights are out, I hear all kind of noise in my house? And it's like I hear creaking and cracking, and I just lay in the bed saying, God, please let it be the animals. Please let it be the animals. Fear of the dark. I don't like that darkness. Fear of intimacy. A lot of people struggle with intimacy, being intimate with others. Fear of death. That's another one that a lot of people have a fear of. My husband always said, he had a little saying, he used to always say, there are no atheists in foxholes, you know, because people, like, they learn Jesus real quick when they think they're going to die. Fear of death. Fear of failure. Fear of failure. That's a big one. Big one. Last Sunday, Pastor Sheila talked about winning and losing and how nobody likes to lose. Nobody likes to fail, but some of the greatest successes have come on the backs of failure. So that's another one. Fear of rejection. That's another one nobody likes. You know, when I read this, it took me right back to third grade. Fear of rejection. We were out on the field picking teams for some sport. Who wants to be the last person chosen? Not me. I couldn't stand it. It was like, please just let somebody choose me. I didn't want to feel that rejection. Fear of spiders, mice, rodents, that kind of thing. Don't have to say much about that. And fear of commitment. And that's another one that a lot of people have, a fear of committing to something. They have a fear of commitment. And I want to add one more fear, and that is fear of answered prayer. And I say this because I had a little thing happen recently. You know, I read a little devotional every day. And if I'm really inspired by it, I'll put it on Facebook and say, ooh, look at this wonderful scripture I read today. And so recently, I had posted one on Facebook, and the devotional was from Hebrews 16, which says, and so after waiting patiently, Abraham received what was promised. So I really liked that. I really liked that. So I posted it, and I made a little comment, and I said, I could probably use some of Abraham's patience. We can all use patience, right? Well, one of my sisters real quick wrote on there, be careful, Sister Beth, what you pray for, you just might get it. So I wrote back and I said, well, I didn't say I prayed for it. I just said I thought I needed it, right? So, but, I started thinking about that and I was chewing on that a little bit. I thought, why should I be afraid for something that will work out something that God wants in me? Why should that cause fear in us? We should want everything that God has in mind for us, no matter what it takes to get us there. So we should want those answered prayers and those kind of things. And I thought about Romans 5. Sarah, will you put that scripture up? And I took this from the Message Bible because I really like the way it says it. It says, we continue to shout our praise even when we're hemmed in with troubles, because we know how troubles can develop passionate patience in us, and how that patience in turn forges the tempered steel of virtue, helping us stay alert for whatever God will do next. In alert expectancy such as this, we're never left feeling shortchanged. Quite the contrary. We can't round up enough containers to hold everything God generously pours into our lives through the Holy Spirit. I want to have that in my life. I want to be able to not gather up enough containers to hold everything that God wants to pour into my spirit. So I love this. It's beautifully said in the Message Bible. So I want to encourage you today to be bold in your prayers. Pray for things that might bring you a little discomfort, because the good that it's going to bring in the long run is going to way outweigh that discomfort. Recently, I was thinking about young people. I used to work at the Orange County Rescue Mission. A lot of you guys know that. And there was a lot of young people there, a whole lot of young people. And I mean, they were on fire for the Lord. And there is nothing like being around young people who are on fire for God. I mean, there's just an energy that evolves around that gets you on fire and keeps you going and keeps you energized. And so I found I was missing these young people. So I began to pray, Lord, please bring some young people in my life. I've always loved being around young people. God, bring them to church, bring them somewhere in my life, but bring me some young people, Father. I want that energy. So about that time, a good friend of mine, who happens to be in her 30s, she gave me a call and she said, Beth, there's going to be a conference. There's going to be a conference in L.A. You want to go? It's by this church. It's a church called Oasis. And I'm like, I never heard of them. She said, oh, yeah, they're big in L.A. You want to go? And I said, I don't know. And she said, well, Beth Moore's going to be there. I'm like, I'm there. I'm good. Okay, if Beth Moore's going to be there, I'm in. So I have a group of sisters that when we go to a conference, I don't care if that conference is in Anaheim, if it's in L.A., if it's in Arizona, we get a hotel. We get a room because we want to stay in that moment. We want to stay in the essence of that conference time and that time with the Lord. So we get a room. So this friend and I, we got a room. It's a two-day conference, so we got a room up in L.A., and we are some super Christians. We took a vacation day to go to the conference, okay? So we took Friday off to go to this conference, and we drove up to the conference. Conference was in the Dolby Center, right in the heart of LA. It was an amazing thing. And so we went up to this conference, we checked in our hotel room, and then we went over and checked in the conference. And as soon as I got into this conference and we walked around a little bit, I was like, wow, I'm in the minority. I mean, if I had to guess, I would say there were 90% 20 and 30-somethings, okay? Full of young people there to praise the Lord everywhere. So it was good. We had a great, great, wonderful time. But the second day, toward the end of the conference, they had this praise band that came up. You guys think Debbie and these guys are loud? Psh, they're nothing. You know, these guys were loud. And I mean, it was boom, 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 boom. And everybody was on their feet. Woo, 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 praising God. Lights out, laser lights, colored lights everywhere, strobe lights flashing. They were dropping streamers. And then these big, huge balloons started bouncing out everywhere. They passed out glow sticks. Matter of fact, I've got a picture of me and my friend. There we are, praising the Lord with a gazillion young people. It was like, well, she's a young person, too. But anyway, I looked it up. The Dolby holds 3,000 people. So, I mean, everybody was on their feet, jumping up and down. So this went on and on and on. And finally, I told my friend, I got to sit down. These young people are wearing me out. So I sat down, and I'll be honest with you, because I love you guys. You guys know me. I started to murmur and complain. I was like, Lord, are we about done? Are they about to wrap this up? Because my feet hurt, my hip hurts, everything on me is hurting. And you know how quick God will remind you of something? He said, Beth, you asked for young people. I'm giving you some young people to praise God with. Now get up. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. So I drug my weary body up on my feet and says, yes, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And this is how we ended up praising God, glow sticks and all. It was a wonderful, wonderful time. So I tell you that story just to say, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to ask God for something because it might hurt a little bit. You might get a little tired, but he'll give it to you. He'll give it to you. Okay, so let's look at these other fears. I looked at this list. I'm like, fear of spiders, check. Rejection, check. Failure, check, check, check. I got all of those. You know, I thought about how many times that fear of rejection has maybe stopped us from doing something that God wants us to do. You know, a lot of times God will lay something on your heart, and it can be something simple, and God really drove this home to me this week. This is how simple it can be. I go to Curbs every two or three times a week, you know, trying to stay fit, and I was in Curves the other day, and I'm working out hard, and there were these two ladies in there. And one of them, she had a T-shirt on. It had a martini glass, and it said, it's 5 o'clock somewhere. So I'm working out, and I'm thinking, oh, aren't they cute, you know. And then God says, I want you to go invite them to church. I'm like, really, Lord? You know, so I start having this conversation with God about this. I'm like, I don't know. I don't know them. I don't want to bother them. I was afraid of being rejected. I was afraid of what they might say back to me. And so finally, through all this conversation with God, what I realized was that rather than beat myself up for 2 weeks for not doing it, I'd rather just go do it and get it over with, even if it meant rejection. So I said, okay. Now here's the funny part. I don't know if this is God having a sense of humor or what. So I went over to the ladies. I said, hi, how you doing? Oh, hell, fine, fine. I said, well, if you guys don't have a church that you attend on Sunday, I'm going to speak at my church this Sunday if you'd like to come. Oh, honey, we're Jehovah's Witnesses. I said, oh, okay. Does that elder know you're wearing that martini T-shirt? It's all good, but, yeah, I was surprised. I'll be honest. I was a little surprised. So anyway, but yeah, so I didn't get rejected. We introduced ourselves. It was all good. And I did what I felt like I was being led to do. So don't be afraid. Sometimes it ends up just being a laugh at the end of the day. So, but I want to talk about some people in the Bible now. So enough about some of our experiences here. But I want to talk about Moses. As Moses had the fear of failure and rejection. You know, and we all know God used Moses in a mighty way, in a mighty way. So when Moses is at the burning bush, God is speaking to him, and he's telling him, I want you to go to Pharaoh on behalf of the Israelites. And Moses is saying, Pharaoh's not going to want to talk to me. What? Are you kidding? Pharaoh doesn't want to talk to me? He was afraid that Pharaoh would reject him. Not to mention, you know, he had that little murder thing hanging over his head. But you know, he was afraid of rejection, I believe, failure and rejection. So God finally convinces him, I'll be with you. I'll be with you, Moses. It's going to be okay. So Moses is like, okay. Okay, but what about the Israelites? What about the Israelites? What if they ask me questions? What if they ask me questions? What do I tell them? What do I tell them? And God says, he gave Moses very specific instructions. Tell them that I am sent you. And he walked Moses through his fears and his concerns. And with these instructions, he told him, he said, I will be with you, Moses. This is the biggest thing you can ever remember when you're facing fear, is that God is with you. He's with you. He's always with you. So he tells Moses, I am with you. And when you're going through something and you feel that fear, you remember what God says to Moses, I am with you. And you better believe if you are in the middle of something that God has asked you to do or ordained you to do, or if you're just living your life the way that you're supposed to be living your life, you know, following Christ and doing what you're supposed to be doing, you better believe God is with you. He's always with you. So don't forget that he will be with you. And then let's talk about Gideon. Gideon's another one of my favorites. In Judges 6, the Israelites, it says the Israelites had again done evil in the eyes of the Lord. So it says they had spent 40 years in peace under Deborah's leadership. Now, I love this little piece right there. Don't miss that. that they had peace under Deborah's leadership. Don't let anybody tell you a woman cannot be a leader in the kingdom of God. Because, you know, Deborah, 40 years under the leadership of Deborah right there in Judges. So when they cried out to God, the Israelites had come under oppression by the Midianites at the time. So they were being oppressed by the Midianites. And they cried out to God. And who does God send an angel to? He sends an angel to Gideon. And I love this because it says, it's such a beautiful story. When you have a chance, you need to go read Judges 6. It says, the angel came and sat under the oak. Wouldn't that be amazing to be somewhere and have an angel come sit down under the tree and talk to you? Oh my gosh. So, but I want you to note too where Gideon was at the time. Gideon, it says Gideon was threshing. Okay, typically they did their threshing outside, but it says Gideon was threshing in a wine press. And a couple of commentators that I read said that this is probably because he was afraid of the Midianites. So already Gideon is a scaredy cat. We know he's an afraid kind of guy. He's hiding out in the wine press from the Midianites. But this is who God chose to send the angel to. So the angel comes, he sits down under the oak, and he's telling Gideon some stuff. You know, he's telling him, want you to go in the strength that you have and save Israel from Midian, mighty warrior. And I think this must have just went like right over Gideon's head because Gideon didn't respond. You know, now you think about it. If God sent an angel came in, say he came in this church right now and sat down right next to you, and he said, blah, 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 mighty warrior, what is your response going to be? Me? Mighty warrior? Did God say that? Did he say I'm a mighty warrior? I would be some kind of excited, but Gideon did not. Gideon did not get excited. You know what Gideon did? He's thinking, this angel must not know who I am. He must be under the wrong tree because I need to tell him who I am. And so Gideon says to this angel, he says, you know, Mr. Angel, I am from the weakest clan. Mighty warrior? I don't think so. And not only am I from the weakest clan, I am the least in the family. I'm the least in the family. But just like with Moses, this angel assured Gideon that the Lord would be with him. And he was. He was. You know, Gideon finally said okay. And Gideon went and rounded up a whole bunch of folks. He had an army of 32,000 people. God said, too many. Too many. Too many. And he finally ended up defeating the Midianites with an army of only 300. I imagine in all of this that Gideon's fear simply did not go away. I would guess that Gideon went out there knees knocking, praying his guts out to God. You know, Lord, you got to be with me. You've got to help me. And that's where we should be. That's where we should be all the time because that's how God gets the glory. In our most scared moments, that's how God gets the glory. You know, he loves to do the most unlikely things with the most least likely people. You know, God will use that because it brings him glory. Because it's not about us, you see. It's not about us. We make that mistake all the time. We think that it's all about us, but it's not. When people reject us, they're rejecting God. They're not rejecting us. It's not about us. I love what Paul had to say in 1 Corinthians, I think it's like 1 Corinthians 1, 26 through 28. Paul has described himself. Now, this is Paul describing himself. He says, I am a Hebrew of Hebrews. I was circumcised on the eighth day of the tribe of Benjamin, faultless when it came to zeal and legalistic righteousness. We all know Paul was an educated man. Paul was a very educated man. He was truly a Hebrew of Hebrews. But listen what he had to say to the common Corinthians. It says the Corinthians that he was speaking to in this instance, they were common people. They were common people. He said to them, if God had chosen based on a criteria, the world's criteria of breeding, wisdom, and influence, they would have been passed by, like most of us. If God chose based on influence, education, wisdom, all of that kind of stuff, I know he would have passed me right on by. It would have been not even a thought for me. But that's not what God does. When God calls, he turns the world's standards upside down, and he takes the most unlikely. He chooses the Gideons, the Moses, the fishermen, the unlikely people of ordinary standing, plain regular people just like me and you, so that no one can boast. So we ought to rejoice that we're just regular folks here at the Hope Center of Christ, but we are mighty warriors in God's kingdom. Hallelujah. Thank you. So I believe that what the world rejects, that God swings the doors of heaven wide open and says, come on in. He really does that. So what about the fear of failure? I just want to touch on that briefly because I know many of you in this room have dealt with the fear of failure, whether it's in your finances, in your relationships, in your health. There's a lot of areas where we can fail. And like I said earlier, many, many successes came on the back of failure. So don't give up. Don't give up. As long as you have your faith, then you can face it, your fear, with confidence. Remembering God is with you. He is always, always with you. God may be bringing a new thing for you. You know that door that closed at that job that you thought you had to have? You know? I mean, you guys, most of you will remember the story when I went to the Orange County Rescue Mission. When I went there, when I walked on the grounds, I knew I was going to work there. I knew. I felt it in my spirit. I am going to work here. I told Pastor Sheila, I'm going to work here. I'm going to work here. And so I went immediately and applied for the little receptionist job. And when I got the phone call on Friday that said, sorry, you didn't get the job, I'll tell you the truth. I threw myself across my bed and cried all weekend. Poor Brian, he was like, woman, get up. What is wrong with you? I'm like, I didn't get the job. I just knew God wanted me to be there, you know. And I knew in my heart, I knew that that wasn't going to happen. I was like, oh, no, I so knew that I heard from God. But then Monday came. And I've never forgotten this lesson that God taught me, because Monday came and they called me. And you guys all know, I was the executive assistant to the president there for 3 years. God didn't want me in that little receptionist job. So I say that to tell you that sometimes when he closes a door, he's getting ready to open another door. And when he opens that door, you better be ready to walk through it. And don't be afraid. Because why? Because he is with you. He is with you. He is with you. I want to share with you two things that Dr. Schuller always said that I always loved so much. And I kind of loved them because they were kind of silly. I thought that was the appeal of it to me. The first one is, God uses your bruises. That's how he used to say it, kind of. Yeah. But you guys have probably heard him say it, God uses your bruises. And I thought, oh, that's funny. But it's true. How many stories have you heard about people who have been just beaten down, who have had the roughest, hardest times in life, and then God has done something fabulous in their life? I say, if it can happen for them, why not me? You know, if it can happen for them, it can happen for you. You know, so just believe that God is always with you. The other thing he used to say that I used to like so much was, let God turn your scars into stars. You know, he will take that awful thing and do something beautiful with it. I've seen it time and time again. A lot of us remember all the interview guests that used to come through that came from the most unlikely places. And then they ended up doing something really amazing. Jim and I were just having a conversation out on the porch before church about Garrett Anderson and how he spoke last night at the baseball game and talked about what Christ did in his life, how he changed him, and how he would be nowhere without him. Garrett Anderson, who played baseball for the Angels, and as Jim said it beautifully, in front of 40-something thousand people, praising God, thanking God for what he did in his life. So you just never know. You never know. So I want to leave you with two things about fear before we wrap it up here. Sarah, if you can put those up there. You can do two things with fear. Number one, you can forget everything and run. Or number two, you can face everything and rise. Rise to do the things that God is calling you to do. Rise to live a life worthy of a kingdom. Rise to live a life that brings honor and glory to our Heavenly Father. So today, I want to ask you, I've got some cards. I think Becca and, I'm sorry, your name is, Okay, you have got some, Debbie, they've got the cards that they're going to pass out. And what I want you to do today is I want you to write a fear that you've been facing. I know all of us have something. I mean, like I said, whether it's financial, whether it's something to do with your children, maybe you have a fear with your children, but they're going to pass out the cards right now and give everybody a card, right? Thank you. And you write that fear on this card. And we are going to, I'm going to ask Debbie and those guys to come up, back up now, and maybe while they're singing, if you can put these cards in the basket while they're singing, and then I'm going to ask Sheila and Harold to come up, and then let's pray over these fears and let God take care of them. So we're basically just going to leave our fears in the, at the altar today. I appreciate you guys. I love you guys. You're an amazing church. Let me just tell you now, I know that many of you are mighty warriors, and you're strong and you're courageous. And please do always remember that in God's eyes, you are beautiful, you are loved, and you are all mighty warriors. Sorry, I changed up the service a little bit.
Beautiful.
So we're shaking it up a little bit. We're not going to do the service in the normal order. They're going to sing. You're going to bring your cards up, and then we're going to pray. Is that okay? Okay.
Jacob wrestled with the Lord all night, and when daybreak came, Jacob said to God, "I'll hold on to you," but God said, "Let me go." Bible says the vision is for the appointed time. It hastens toward the goal. It will not fail. Though it tarries, wait for it will surely come. It will not delay. That's the word of the Lord for you today. Come on now.
Just like Jacob, I will wrestle. I'll hold on tight to your promise, oh Lord. You have promised me your blessings will come to pass, Lord, of this I am sure.
Oh,
Okay.
Do we want to start praying? Of course we want to start praying over all these fears. Can we just lift them up, Beth, you and Harold, and let us just, all of you, reach your hands out towards them. Lord God Almighty, you are the great I am. Not the I was, not the I will be, but I am.
Thank you, Lord.
Always I am. You are. And you are love. And perfect love casts out all fear.
Thank you, Lord.
Perfect love. And yours is the only love, the only perfect love that casts out all fear. And if we have a spirit of fear, it is not because of you. You have not given us a spirit of fear, but you have given us a spirit of
power,
love, and a sound mind. So, Lord, now we take these fears, we lay them at your feet, and we leave them here with you. What wonderful, strong, powerful hands hold these fears. And now, Lord God, I ask, Holy Spirit, that you will surprise the people that are here, every soul that is here, every soul that has brought this fear and placed it at your feet, that you will now, Holy Spirit, infuse them with your presence, infuse them with that spirit of power, infuse them with that spirit of love, infuse them with that spirit of a sound mind, infuse them with a spirit of faith, of faith and courage. Oh, Lord, I thank you. The people that are here today, you have called them by name. They are yours. They belong to you. And you are committed. Your reputation's on the line for fulfilling your promise to take care of each and every one of them. And so, Lord, we trust you now. We leave them here knowing that you will take care.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for that faith, that peace that now infuses us in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Pastor Harold, did you feel like you want to pray too?
In the name of Jesus Christ, Father, who is our Lord and Savior. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word that we had today.
Yes.
Dear Heavenly Father, may we go forward knowing that sometimes our knees do buckle or they do shake. But the most important thing, dear Heavenly Father, is that we are obedient to your word. Dear Heavenly Father, sometimes fear, well, all the time fear, comes from the evil one, dear Heavenly Father, who tries to block the blessing that you have for us. Dear Heavenly Father, we succeed not because of us. We succeed because of you, dear Heavenly Father. It was a testimony this morning when the pastor had approached Jehovah's Witnesses, dear Heavenly Father. But it didn't matter whether they came to church or not. It mattered that she was obedient to your leading, dear Heavenly Father.
Amen.
We may never know what heart was changed during that little small exchange of friendship and kindness, and that they saw the dear love of Jesus through her precious, precious eyes. And dear Heavenly Father, we just pray, dear God, that we will walk always in courage, knowing, dear Heavenly Father, that we are being attacked. I think about Jacob when he wrestled with the angel, dear Heavenly Father. And before the wrestle, he was told that I've been trying to get here, but the powers of darkness was holding me back. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe that we all have ministering angels, dear Heavenly Father,
that goes
into battle with us and to bring us through victoriously because we have received you as our Lord and Savior. And dear Heavenly Father, let us go in faith. Fear not, because we know that you cause all things to work together for good to those who love you. And dear Heavenly Father, and even though we may go forward in fear, dear God, I am not remiss in to believing and understanding that even some of our greatest heroes in the Bible went forth in fear, dear Heavenly Father. It is okay to come to you and to let you know that we are fearful, dear Heavenly Father, because you will give us the power and the victory, dear Heavenly Father, to overcome anything. And dear Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful that we serve a powerful God, dear Heavenly Father, creator of the universe. And because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ is the only reason why we have any power and any victory over darkness, dear Heavenly Father. It's not by our power and it's not by our might, dear Heavenly Father. It is through your awesome power and might. And we love you, dear Heavenly Father. And dear God, this is a great testimony to you right now, dear Heavenly Father, that we are a praying church. Dear Heavenly Father, we are a praying church for your children, and we believe that these prayers that have been given in this basket, dear Heavenly Father, will be answered. Will be answered, dear Heavenly Father, in the way that you will it. And I just pray, dear Heavenly Father, that your children that are here today will walk in courage and in understanding and in wisdom, dear Heavenly Father, that you care for each and every one of your children. Christ said, we are no longer slaves, but we are children and friends of you, dear Heavenly Father, and we walk in that faith. He said, whatever you pray for, believe that ye shall receive and ye shall have, dear Heavenly Father. And thank you, Jesus. And I just like to give you all glory, honor, and praises. You are wonderful and worthy to be praised. You are wonderful and worthy to be praised. In Jesus' name.
Father God, we just praise you this morning, Lord. We thank you, Father, that it is already done. It is already done. So let everyone leave with the confidence today that every fear that they have placed in this basket is already taken care of. God is with you. He goes with you. He goes before you and makes a way. Lord, I thank you for your presence. I thank you for today. I thank you for everyone here, Lord. And I just ask that you give them safe passage home, Father, and bless them throughout the rest of the week. And let them know that they are mighty warriors. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I want you just thank you. Can you thank Beth for that wonderful, wonderful message? And before I give you the benediction, I have one thing I need to do. Becca, come on down here. Becca starts Biola this week or next week? Next week. So proud of her. We prayed for her that God would show her the college to go to, and then she asked God to help her get into Biola, and then she asked him for the financing to Biola, and Mom and Dad, did you put that fear in this basket? No, that's good. That's good. But I just want to say a prayer of blessing over Becca. She takes this big step. Thank you for joining me in that. Lord, thank you for this precious, precious daughter of yours. Her beautiful, amazing smile, her courageous stand for you on Facebook with her friends at work who do not know you. Lord, she is a light for you no matter where she goes. And you have a plan for her life, a plan for good and not evil, to give her a future and a hope. And Lord, you've opened the door to this college, Biola, wonderful school. And Lord, we just pray that you will just be with her now. We can't wait to hear as she gets into all of her classes with her teachers, her Christian teachers, the classmates that are Christians. And yet she may find some surprises there that are not as what she expected. But Lord, we thank you that you were with her every step of the way, just like Beth taught us this morning. So bless her, Lord, and surround her with your protection.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Love you. All right. And now, here's the benediction for the day. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you that peace. Hallelujah. Peace that passes all understanding. May he give you that faith that is unshakable and hope that is unsinkable and love that is unquenchable. God loves you, and so do we. Amen. God bless you. Amen.
God is truly awesome. He reigns in majesty.
Center. We'll see you next week.